can see you all's lovely faces as we get this thing going.
Hello, everyone.
Hey. Dee, are we going to get started maybe about 3 minutes after, 2 or 3 minutes, to give people a couple minutes to sign in?
We're going to give people an opportunity to join before we get started. And we are waiting for our presenter, Adam Tidrow, and co-presenter Anthony Dixon to join the call. I think they're wrapping up a prep session, but they'll be joining us momentarily.
Awesome. Can you either make me a co-host, or I'm going to put on some music while people are signing in to get the
energy. Absolutely.
That would be awesome.
Let me just find you in here, Adam. Anthony, I'm so sorry. I'm calling you everybody except Duncan. That's terrible. I am so sorry.
It's okay. My parents and my grandparents do the same thing.
Oh my God, are you calling me old?
I'm like, I'm the favorite son. How
y'all? Day. Maybe that'll kind of make the pain go away. Trying to forgive you for abandoning me. Praying, but I think I'm still an angel away. Angel away, yeah, strange in a way. Maybe that is why I chase strangers away. They got their guns out aiming at me, but I become Neo when they aiming at me. Me against them. Me against enemies, me against friends. Somehow they both seem to become one. A sea full of sharks and they all smell blood. They start coming and I start rising. Must be surprising, I'm just surmising. I win, pop, soar, hiya, 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 roar.
I've been rolling around, always looking dead in all I see. And painted faces filled with places I can't reach. And you know that I could use somebody behind. You know that I could use somebody.
Someone like me, somebody.
I'm ready now, I'm ready now, I'm ready now, and I'm ready now, I'm ready now, I'm ready now, I'm ready now. So what a liar.
D, you ready to get going?
Yes, Duncan. Thank you so much for that music. Getting us all in the mood, right? Get started. Thank you guys so much for joining us this morning. We have an amazing group of people here this morning. What do we have? 52 participants so far, and people are still joining. Thank you so much for joining. Just love to see your amazing, resilient faces. Welcome. 2020 cohort of entrepreneurs. We are probably the first stop in your journey to entrepreneurship and financial independence, and we are thrilled to be part of that journey. We hope that you will get what you need to take the next step towards starting your own business, building wealth, leaving a legacy for your family and for your community. Out of this series, and we hope to keep you engaged and informed. And let me now turn it over to Duncan, who's gonna kick us off. Thank you, Duncan.
All right, good morning, everybody. I'm so excited today because, you know, it's about what? You said 55 people on here so far. I sent this information out to at least 4,000 people who said that they ready to open a business, grow their idea, and you all said, you know what, there's an opportunity, I'm gonna take it. That's how you be successful, right? When the opportunity presents itself, you don't let it pass you by. And this right here is an opportunity, all right? I wasn't joking when I reached out to you all and we did the post. If you got a side hustle, you got an idea, you got a job, you selling stuff out the trunk of your car, you tabling at events, it is possible for that business, that idea, to turn into your full-time job, where you actually are hiring other people to work for you doing that idea. But you need some support. And a lot of entrepreneurs, especially in Buffalo and Western New York, Pennsylvania, and Ohio, a lot of entrepreneurs, they feel alone. Like you're just trying to, you know what I'm saying, figure it out, just robbing Peter to pay Paul, trying to figure out all the documents, everything you gotta do. Well, you don't gotta do that no more. You don't gotta figure it out by yourself no more. Pathstone's Legit will help you with a free business coach. They'll help you fix your credit. They got funding. Pathstones is not a bank. They are not Pathstone Enterprise Center. Is not a bank. They're a nonprofit. So they are going to be able to actually do lending from $5,000 to $250,000 to small businesses. So they're going to hand walk you through the whole process to turn your business into a full-time business. And today is part of the boot camp. This is the first in a series of boot camps. So don't think like, oh, I went today, I'm feeling good, I'm ready to go. No, you come every week, get all the knowledge, get all the information, right? Because then when it's time for funding, they're going to be like, how many boot camps you been to? Oh, I came to the first one. And there's three people over here that's been eight in a row with their graduation certificate, like, what's up, right? So you guys got to maximize these opportunities. So I'm not going to talk long. All right. So my role this morning is to get everybody feeling good, get everybody to be present, because it's possible to be here without being here. Does anybody know what I mean? Like you are physically here, but you're not here. I see your head nodding, Mr. Tate. Come off of mute and tell me how can you be here and not be here?
Yo, physical is here, but you're not present. They say usually we check out with like every 3 minutes, 2 minutes, something like that. So what you doing is you make sure everybody hyped. So sometimes you probably gonna tell us to get up, dance around, sit back down, type stuff like that. Like, it, you know, so you could be here and just be zoned out, especially it's easy to do it on Zoom calls.
Mm-hmm. We all zoomed out. We done been getting beat down by Zoom, right? You know what I mean? I'm sure all of y'all like professional at the top half and joggers and basketball shorts on the bottom half, you know? So I'm not going to have you dance around, but I am going to do a listening activity. And again, if you don't mind coming off of, turning your video camera on, it will make it so much better for the presenters to be able to see your faces, see your reactions, see your energy, because you're going to get out of this what you put in. Now, listen, if you got the bonnet on, you just rolled out of bed, it's cool. We all chilling in the quarantine. You know what I mean? We all doing what we can do. So as the presenters are, now again, if you're not comfortable with it or you're busy, you know, that's fine. But if you can, we want to see your faces, all right? So we're going to do this listening activity. It is a listening activity. I'm going to read you something, and then I'm going to ask you one question. So if you know the answer, you are going to raise your hand, okay? You're not going to put it in the chat. You're not going to come off of mute and say it out loud. You're going to raise your hand. So what are we going to do if we know the answer? Let me. Can everybody demonstrate? What do you do if you know the correct answer? Got the hands raised. I'm going across the screens. Okay, boom. If you don't know the correct answer, give me this, the thumbs down. Go ahead. Let me see everybody. Because some of y'all are going to be doing this in a couple of seconds. All right, the thumbs down. That's like, what is you talking about? All right. So remember, this is not a gimmick. It's not a trick. This is a listening activity. All you got to do is listen. All right. So here we go. You are driving a bus. At the first stop, two people get on the bus. At the second stop, three people get on the bus. At the third stop, one person gets off the bus. Raise your hand if you know the name of the bus driver. If you have no idea, give me the thumbs down. If you like, wait a minute, hold up. I'm looking, hold on, keep them up, keep them up. I'm going across. All right, listen. This is a listening exercise. Now, hands up for who knows. Who knows that they know? Who is 100% sure they know the name? Okay, I see Dwayne. I see Minister Thomas. Come off of mute, Dwayne. Let me ask you this question. You say you know. So do you know what the bus driver had for dinner yesterday?
No.
No, you don't? Okay, then you don't know the name of the bus driver. Okay, so who knows that they know who's the name of the bus driver? No, you 100% sure. Miss, is that Kaylin Price? Do you know, listen, don't tell me who it is. Come off of mute.
I got you.
All right, if you know the name of the bus driver, do you know the bus driver's favorite cousin?
Yeah, he lives in Vegas.
Exactly. All right, thank you. Go back on mute. Now, raise your hand. Now, give me the thumbs down if you're even more confused now than before. Give me the thumbs down if you're like, wait, what is going on right now? Okay, so I'm going to read the story again, and then I'm going to ask you the same question, okay? So remember, this is a listening activity. So you have to listen in order to get the information. You are driving a bus. At the first stop, two people get on the bus. The second stop, three people get on the bus. The third stop, one person gets off the bus. Raise your hand if you know the name of the bus driver. Raise it up high, keep it up. Is there any, okay, everybody got it. Okay, so why do we do that activity? Because I said, I need you to listen. And literally the first word that I said was the answer and we missed it, okay? So when you listen, you're not listening with you like, oh, I already know that, right? Because how many of y'all was counting? How many of y'all caught yourself counting, right? So don't assume that you know the answer. Don't assume that you know the answer before they even ask you the question. Come to this workshop fully present. Be open to new information. You got questions, ask questions. Engage with these speakers. These people do this full time. So engage with these speakers. They're going to give you knowledge. They're going to give you opportunity. But you're not going to get it if you're not here or you think you already know something before you even heard it. So, all right? So that's what we want to do. And with that, I want to say thank y'all all for being here. This is going to be a great workshop. I've already talked with the staff at Pathstone Enterprise Center, and I got to meet a couple of the presenters, so they know their stuff. So now it's time for y'all to get the knowledge, start processing, come back next Monday, get some more knowledge, start processing, and then start building your business. And they're going to help you. And then when you're like, all right, well, now how am I going to get the money? Oh, Pathstone got you on that. How do I do social media? Pathstone's got you consultants that teach you how to do social media for your business. Consultants that teach you how to do your finance. Everything you need is with Pathstone right here. So again, my name is Duncan Kirkwood. I really appreciate it and y'all being here. And I want to kick it over to Adam, who is the business. Let me get his title right. You know, I like to get people's titles right. You know what I mean? He is the business development officer for the Buffalo office of Pathstone Enterprise Center. So with that, I'll kick it over to Adam and thank you all again for being here.
Thank you so much. Oh.
Go ahead, Dion.
No, I just wanted to thank Duncan personally Duncan is like, you know, the Energizer Bunny. He's getting us all going and ready for this amazing workshop this morning. And before we introduce Adam, I do want to introduce myself, my amazing team in Buffalo. Adam Tidrow, he's a business development officer in Buffalo. And Jahida Zapata, who is also a business development officer in Buffalo. You will be seeing their faces and hearing their voices over the next 7 weeks. And without further ado, I will turn it over to Adam.
Thank you, Dion. And thank you, everybody, for joining us on this lovely Monday morning. And if you guys aren't energized after listening to Duncan, there's no amount of caffeine that's going to help you. I think Duncan's energy can get the rest of us through at least Monday, if not Tuesday and Wednesday. So Duncan, thank you so much for doing a good job of getting everybody engaged and energized and ready to learn. So like Dion said, I'm Adam Tidrow. I'm a business development officer here at Pathstone, and I'm actually a transplant from Indianapolis. I've been in Pathstone since December. So I'm still learning everybody and learning the area, and quickly really loving Western New York. And I think it was the last day before we went on quarantine, Dion and I ended up having to go out to a more rural area of Western New York and picking up some furniture for the office, and just being able to drive around Western New York, you know, Rochester and Buffalo and everywhere in between, and seeing how just beautiful the landscape is, it was nice. And it kind of makes it feel like home. So, but that's who I am. And before we get into the nitty gritty here, I'll tell you, I have 2 degrees in entrepreneurship and business development. This is what I do. This is what I love. And that's why I'm here. What we're talking about today, this is what I'm passionate about. I'm passionate about working with entrepreneurs and small business owners who are ready to take their life and build it into what they desire. And the life you dream of, when you're sitting at your 9-to-5 and you're watching the clock, because you're not living the life you want, and you're here because now you know your desires and you're ready to capitalize on that and take action. So, and Pathstone is here to help. And part of the Pathstone team is Jahida Zapata, and you will be seeing her and hearing from her both in the chat throughout this series. And she will be running some of the polls we're putting up. And Jahida does a great job of marketing for us. She has put together all of our marketing material and all the emails and social media posts on this, as well as this incredible presentation. So if you guys would have seen the presentation I put together, just the bare bones of it, nobody would be here still. It was horrible. And Jahida was able to put it into a template that she built and keep it engaged. So Jahida, thank you so much for doing that. And real quick, I want to introduce my counterpart today, Anthony Dixon from Spa Capital Management here in Western New York. And I want to give Anthony an opportunity. He is our co-creator, and he is an expert. He's one of the experts in the room today. And Anthony, do you want to just take a minute and introduce yourself?
Yeah, thank you again, everyone. I am so excited to be here. Again, my name is Anthony Dixon. I am a partnership investor and small business consultant with Spa Capital Management. Spa Capital Management is a holding company that invests in Main Street businesses through a partnership model. So if you're excited or interested in how that works, follow me at sapcm.com. There's a really cool video there that goes by my words, my story, my journey, give you an idea to understand who I am and how I like to help. I definitely want to thank everyone for coming out and being committed to this actual workshop. It's going to be pretty amazing. It's going to be a cool opportunity, like they said, to understand where you are and how to get to where you want to be. So thank you for committing to not just today, but all 7 weeks if you can, and four at least to get through the graduation. Startup is exciting. I don't know how anybody on this call who has been on a startup, but I've been in 6 startups, 4 personally, 2 on my personal own. I mean, four of my personal, two as a team, and I got to exit out of two of them really cool in an exciting way. So I'm excited for you guys. I'm excited for you to get started and get to where you want to be. Before we get there, I bet you have three reasons why you were here. And one of those reasons is you wanted to build a community. It takes a network, it takes a team to build a business. So this is definitely a place to be. Like Duncan said, high energy that he gave it to you. If you want it, you gotta go out there and strive to get it. So we are going to give you an opportunity to tell who you are and to put your information in the chat. And I definitely, definitely, definitely highly suggest that you put your information there. And look who's there in the room. Not the person with the biggest title on this call is going to be the one that helps you. It's probably one of your peers. So this is an important time to go follow them on LinkedIn, go see where they are on Facebook or on their website to see how they can help you grow your business and get it to where it needs to be. You also need a mentor. A mentor is pretty exciting to help you get to those things that you're trying to reach. There's a pretty cool quote. I just read a book by Spencer Johnson, MD. He wrote for Avon Books. And his quote is really passionate that I thought that was important for you guys to understand and live by. No one can ever learn fully through someone else's explanation, but sometimes a hint or two can help us pull the answers from within. Again, you guys have the energy, you have the answers. It's just you need somebody to help you find out how to pull that out of yourselves and move forward. The second reason why you're here is because you're trying to build that business acumen, that business knowledge, right? You're going to hear some terms that are just going to be thrown around. What's a business model? What's a P&L sheet? What's a profit and loss statement? What in the world they keep talking about revenue? Why are they talking about an LLC versus a S-Corp? Why are they talking about information on a marketing plan versus marketing strategies? And what are the difference? Why am I a salesperson when I just want to be here? So these are things that you are going to learn. And it's super important that it's going to get boring. It might get daunting at some times, but push through it because there is going to be some carrots at the end of it. One of the cool things that I'm actually from Philadelphia, so my company is headquarters out of Pennsylvania as well as New York State. And I wanted to share another quote with you from Ben Franklin, if you know of his innovation and the impact that he brought. One of the things he said, an investment in knowledge pays the best interest. And why does he say that? Again, instant gratification means that you're going to get the knowledge today, but you might not implement it until tomorrow. But knowing that information and have it ready to go is going to set you off in a greater trajectory. So definitely thank you for being here. And that last thing, like everybody mentioned, is that startup funding. Like, we need that opportunity to go through traditional banks like KeyBank, who sponsored this workshop. You need to understand what a community development financial institution is with Pathstone Enterprise Center. You also need to understand the core metrics of a business and bootstrapping, understanding how to go from cash flow and running your business that way to looking at using the bank of you. Sometimes it's going into your investment and investing in yourself. Investors like myself, as well as traditional banks, want to see that you are invested, not just sweat equity, but also you got some skin in the game with your money. And the biggest one, even tech companies use this today, is the bank of friends and family, because that is definitely an important place to start, but it's not always the place to go. And so when you go out, you're gonna understand how to build your business through these means, including going to go get debt, another keyword you're gonna understand. So again, we wanna bring this workshop to you to make sure that we provide value, we provide support, we give you that community, we help you with startup funding, and we help you to bridge that gap between your business not an acumen. And the only way to make this better is feedback. So anytime part of this, you can send any one of us on the team your information, what you thought went well, what you thought could be changed, because that is going to be critical for us to make sure that we are designing these workshops for you in mind. And again, if we do get your feedback, you got to give us that second chance. So come back the next time and make sure we implement it. And if we didn't, tell us again and make sure that we hit it for you. I want to thank everyone again for coming, for being here. I want to thank Pathstone for allowing me to partner with them again. Definitely want to thank Duncan for the high energy and everyone for putting the time in. That's me. Thank you, guys. Back to Adam.
Anthony, thank you so much. And thank you for joining us. Like Anthony said, if you guys have feedback through that, please feel free to reach out to us. Put it in the chat even. And I know right now we may have an issue with the presentation on the screen. We're getting that fixed right now. So, but we're going to go ahead and move on to the next slide here. And before we get into the fun stuff, just want to go through a few housekeeping items as we get so we can talk about engagement today and throughout this series. The word is engagement. We want everybody engaged, and I see that there are 97 chat messages right now in the first 20-25 minutes. I love that. That's awesome. If we had 200, I'd be equally as thrilled. So thank you guys so much for engaging. There's a few things you can help with in terms of engagement, and that is one, feel free to speak up and ask questions. Feel free to interrupt. If you're more comfortable doing that than chatting or, you know, sharing in the chat, please feel free. If you'd rather use the chat box, go ahead and do that. And we do have members of the Pathstone team running the chat. If you're not speaking, however, and it looks like everybody's doing a pretty good job of this, go ahead and mute your microphone. And if you're able to, when you do want to share with us, if you have a headset or something that kind of cancels out any kind of feedback, that's a big help if you want to speak to the group. You don't have to turn on your camera, but if you do, you know, make sure you don't have some kind of craziness going on behind you that's going to distract us. I have a pretty weak attention span, so I get distracted pretty easily by what's going on behind you guys. And we're going to take a quick poll real quick. And you're going to see a few of these throughout the presentation today and then throughout the workshop series as a whole here. We're going to take a quick poll and just see how everybody heard about us. So you'll see it pop up on your screen right now. If everybody wants to take a look at the poll and tell the group where you heard about us. And we'll give you about 30 seconds to do that here. Some of you may have heard about us through social media or through our email campaigns. There's Facebook, Instagram. A lot of people heard about us through Duncan. He's done an incredible outreach. He's done an incredible job with outreach for us. So thank you again, Duncan, for making sure that we have people in the seats today. And some of you may have heard about us through family or friends. We have a lot of that going on as well. And, you know, again, like Anthony said, your family and your friends can be your biggest support group. And if they've directed you toward this program, there's a reason, and they believe in you, and they want you to take your business and your life to the next level. So looks like most people shared here, and we had a lot of people. Duncan, you're the plurality, man. Duncan got 39% of people here. So a lot of people found us through Facebook and our email and our, you know, through their own family and friends. So that's great. And thank you everybody for sharing that feedback. Is key for us to continue to do these and make sure that we're reaching you where you are. So you don't have to come find us. We want to go out and find you. So I'll tell you guys a little bit about Pathstone Enterprise Center. We are a nonprofit community development financial institution, a CDFI, which means we're mission-based. We're not a bank. And which means we can do things differently than a bank can do them. We don't have to worry about, you know, processing fees and, you know, making sure that we make a ton of money on every loan. And, you know, our clients are more than numbers to us. Our clients primarily are members of the community. And we are here to help enrich the community and build the community and really build wealth and a strong business community within the community, which then goes to build a better Western New York. So, as a community-based organization that doesn't charge for our services, we can tell you that free means free. And there's no hidden costs. There's no agenda behind this. We're not, you know, using you guys to prop up our own numbers or anything. We're here because we want to be here to help you. And one thing I talk about a lot with entrepreneurs is that my job as a business development officer is to break down every barrier I can to give you the best chance at success. And sometimes, you know, today we're breaking down the barrier of education. So we are looking at informing everybody and educating folks as you guys start on your business journey. And the only way we could do this and provide these free services is through the kindness of our community partners and funders, like the sponsor of this program, which is KeyBank. So we want to thank KeyBank for allowing us to do this outreach and work with to work with all of you and as a group as a whole. So let's go. We'll give you a little overview of what you can expect today and then going forward in this class. And that is, you know, we have this all culminates at the end of this program in a business plan. And so that means we're going to have 8 sessions. And the first 7 sessions are classes. They're going to be like this. They're going to be, you're going to be learning a lot and taking a lot of information in and, you know, communicating and engaging with your classmates, as well as the Pathstone staff and the other experts like Anthony and Duncan who are in the room to help you. And the cool thing is that we've set up so that the 8th class, the 8th session is a graduation. So if you attend 4 of the 7 classes, that's just if you attend a majority of the classes here, we are going to invite you to the final class, which is a graduation ceremony, and it will be virtual, of course. And we'll have you'll get a certificate, and it'll show that you completed this education. And then we're going to invite you, as long as you finish those, you know, 4 of those 7 classes, we're going to invite you to our next level workshop, which is the second phase in this startup series. And we're going to invite you there to learn about some more in-depth topics as you start your business and go on your journey. You're going to learn things about building your idea, which is what we're going to talk about today. You're also going to learn how to define your market and how to actually launch your business and take that first step and make that first sale. You're going to learn how to understand money, which is critical and a little daunting. And then by the end of this, you're going to have a full business plan written, and we're going to use the 7-page business plan method that I've developed over the last several years and have worked with a couple hundred businesses on. So with all that in mind, we're going to launch one more poll before we start the actual class session here. So we're going to take 30 seconds, and I just want to see what stage of life your business is in. Do you just have an idea and you're not ready to start up? Have you taken your idea and started? Are you already in business and maybe you've been in business for a year or two? Maybe you've been in business longer than 2 years. Go ahead and take a look on your screen and fill out this poll and tell us how long you've been in business.
I'm just sending out.
Let's see here. And we've got a lot of people responding. Thank you guys so much for your engagement. This is great. Looks like we have a lot of people who are kind of in that pre-startup phase, that idea phase. And we have a lot of, people who are kind of new to this, which is awesome. Wonderful. Thank you everybody for responding to that. It looks like about 64-65% of everybody here is either in the pre-startup phase or the brand new startup phase where you're less than a year old in your business, which is an exciting place to be. But even if you've been around for a while, you're still going to be able to take a lot away from this workshop. And we've geared it so that it's, we've geared it towards people who are running a business and who are getting ready to run a business. So I think everybody will be able to take a lot away from this. Again, if you guys have questions, please feel free to put them in the chat or, speak up and we'll get to your questions. And I think Dion is running the chat and she'll make sure that I get any kind of chat questions as we go through this. So as we get in here, as we get started, if everybody wants to take 10 or 20 seconds and tell me about their business, tell me your name, your business name, and then what kind of business or business idea you have. And then I can kind of work to gear some of this information towards those types of businesses. I don't want to talk to, you know, if we don't have somebody who's, you know, building the next electric car, or, you know, selling, you know, purple bouncy, you know, purple bouncy balls. I don't want to talk about those businesses since we don't have them in the room.
And this is Anthony again. Remember, everyone's a salesperson, so you got to be comfortable with selling your idea. So I want to see those business ideas. I want to see your name flow on there, because we want to support you all.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Anthony. That's good. Again, you know, you have to, this is one thing Anthony and I talked about as we were putting this together is, you know, the necessity and the opportunity for every entrepreneur to be a salesperson. And, you know, in the beginning, you're the one selling your idea. You're the one selling, you know, this concept to the market and saying, here, I've got this idea and I'm going to show everybody that it's going to work. And I'm going to, you know, I have to prove this to my customers and my competitors. So, and right now is an opportunity to kind of practice that. Tell us who you are and what your business is.
Adam, I'm going to just call in a couple of people.
Okay.
If they're not comfortable with speaking up, then I will just move on to the next question. So Kiana, okay. Mind telling us a little bit about yourself and your business?
Hi, my name is Kiana. I am attempting to launch a kids fitness center, more modeled towards like mimicking an adult fitness center. So if you think of it, you would think of like a Baby Bally's, full service with the equipment and things like that. Also, we want to make individualized meal plans and dietary goals for each child so that they reach healthy weights or either maintain a healthy weight through diet and exercise. My motto is healthy kids make healthy adults.
Wonderful. Right.
Thank you. Jasmine Hardy, would you mind telling us a little bit about yourself and the business?
Well, I'm just a trainer, breastfeeding peer counselor. I was working with a few people, but I want to help families, not just, you know how some programs, they just help single moms or breastfeeding mothers. I want to help families with anything they need, because I know what it's like to struggle. So I would like to start up something where I can help families in need. It doesn't matter if you're a single dad or mom, auntie, whatever. I want to be able to help people out here with clothes, food, anything they need, find an apartment, anything. So that's my idea right now.
Thank you, Jasmine. So there's someone here by the name of V Flunder. V, would you like to tell us a little bit about yourself and your business?
I will. My first name is Valenka. I'm currently a second grade teacher, and I have always had a love for daycare and preschool. So I know that daycare and preschool, like a large center type, is something that's going to definitely be needed. And what really prompted me to do that is that I want to leave something for my daughters when I'm gone, for them to be able to continue to have something. So that's my plan. And also my oldest daughter, Lakia Flunder, is also on here herself with her own business idea.
Great, thank you so much. Black Knights, would you mind sharing?
Yes, my name is Elijah Rollerson with the Black Knights Chess Association. I mentor students from kindergarten through 12th grade through chess. The thought behind it was to give them something different, teach them a game that they can use to apply in real life situations. So I make it relatable to them. Chess is a very skilled game, you have to do a lot of thinking. You have to be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 steps ahead before you make your move. So if we can get our kids strategically planning and being extra prepared, you know, this is one way to help them. So I use chess to do that.
Great. Wonderful. Wonderful. Jill with an E, would you mind sharing?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. My name is Jill Ector. I'm a family nurse practitioner, and seriously looking to start in practice. Thinking about starting with a telehealth focus, and probably starting with medication assisted treatment for opioid addiction. Suboxone therapy. So that's where I'm at right now. If I could expand it into a larger practice, maybe a family practice at some point, you know, we have to see where it goes.
Great. Thank you so much, Joe. Susan, without the E, would you mind sharing?
Sure. Suzanne, you were looking for me?
Yes.
Okay, hi. I am a kindergarten teacher currently, have been working in education my entire life and spent about 20 years doing job placements in the United States for international students, placing 3,000 to 5,000 kids a year. And with everything that's been happening, my goal always was to work with American kids and people that were in need and looking for work. And COVID has kind of created the perfect opportunity to get me to jump back in to action. And my goal is to work with youth groups, kids that are graduating from high school, kids that are aging out of foster care, kids that are coming out of college that are just kind of stuck and saying, where am I going to go? I have businesses across the United States that I'm looking to sell this concept to work with American-based students versus foreign students. So I'm kind of re-exploring my mission and seeing where I can take this.
Thank you, Susan. Lamar, would you mind sharing with us a little bit about yourself and your business?
Hello, yes,
Hello.
My name is Lamar Swan. I landscape. I've been a landscaper in UB, contract UB landscaper for a long time. I'm the actual supervisor. I'm the one who actually trims the UB bush and everything like that. I'm venturing off into my own business. I'm very successful at what I do. And everybody in this chat, if you have a business that you need landscaped outside, I'm the man for you. I'm the best in Buffalo, best in Western New York.
Great, great. Love the pitch. Thank you so much, Lamar. Lakia. Hi. I think you are frozen.
No, here she is. She's on her phone, but I'm just going to let her get here.
Hi, guys. I switched over. I have my volume off, so it's not counteracting with my mom's. But my name is Lakia Flunder. The name of my business is Ciantra's Catering. I've been doing it for a couple of years, and I was saying that I wanted to take my business to the next level. So I've been catering. I do stuff out of my house. I go to different centers and I rent and different things like that. But I do an array of different things. And a couple of things in my business that I want to focus on, like promoting through food, is peace, positivity, love, diversity, and inclusion. And I want all of that to be portrayed through food. And when people come to whatever establishment or whenever they have any of my service, I want them to be able to feel all the things that I just named through my food and through the service. So that's just a little bit about me. And if you guys need some catering, then I'll hook you guys up with the info. So that's all.
Plug it in the chat.
Okay.
Thank you.
No worries. Imran.
Yeah, hi. I'm trying to make a marketplace of business coaches. So I don't know how many people here have used a business coach, but I'm trying to make a marketplace of business coaches.
Oh, okay, great. Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Daniel? Would you like, Daniel?
Okay. Sorry about that. I was looking for the mute button. Good afternoon. Daniel Robertson, currently work for Say Yes Buffalo. Have oversight over our mentoring and boys and men of color initiatives at Say Yes. So my background is in youth development, early childhood education, and organizational leadership. So one of my business ideas would be consulting and tying together all of those skills that I currently use at Say Yes, along with the fact that I have a passion for detailing cars, bartending, and also creating a space where men can come together and have their male grooming needs taken care of. So I'm looking for a way to kind of blend all of those different divisions in together and kind of start to create my little enterprise.
Great. Thank you so much, Danielle. Ebony?
My name is Ebony Warren. I own Ebony Warren Enterprises, LLC. I do business cards, website, posters, flyers. And I also have an online hair store that I just launched.
Oh, great. Wonderful. Thank you. Kaylin. Kaylin? I can unmute you if you'd like me to.
Sorry about that, guys. I was having some technical difficulties. My name is Kaylin Price. I'm just an all-around artist, and I really use my art to kind of convey those things, convey different things to children. I teach in about 5 different Buffalo public schools, but my main medium is photography. I just recently opened a photography studio here in the Elmwood Village, and I'm looking for all the support I can get.
Great, fantastic, good to know. Shelley.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Shelley Gordon, and I'm starting a business called Premier Dog Sports and Event Center. And we're going to have a building where we can train dogs and host dog shows on the weekends. Right now, there's nothing currently big enough in the Buffalo area. So me and my basset hounds drive down to Erie, Pennsylvania every weekend, decided to start this up. So we're building 26 agility, obedience rally. We're gonna have scent work, Schutzen. We're gonna have all kinds of dog sports there.
Sounds really exciting. Maybe I'll stop by with my toy poodle.
There you go. Got something for everybody.
Great. Thanks for sharing. Dwayne.
Hey, how are you? My name is Dwayne Thomas. I work for the city of Buffalo as the photographer, graphic designer, videographer. Also have my own business doing photography, videography, web design, flyer design, any type of design. I also own a credit repair business, but I'm looking to launch a event center where, like, when I do things like videos and things for weddings, they can just come to me for everything, invitations, the weddings, the place for to have the wedding at, and to have the banquet facility. So that's what I'm looking to launch now.
Great, wonderful. So I'm just going to take a couple more folks, but please continue to share about yourself and your business in the chat. We do have to get through the presentation before our time is up. So just gonna call on Atia, if you'd like to unmute and tell us a little bit about yourself and your business.
Yeah, hey everybody, my name is Atia Gordon. I am a certified life coach. I am the founder and CEO of Gifts to Give LLC. GIFT is an acronym for Great Insight for True Success. And I help millennials live a happier and mentally healthier lifestyle by finding and or walking in their purpose. So I'll put my information in the chat if you need that. And thank you, everybody.
Fantastic. And finally, Kerry Gant. If you would like to share a little bit about yourself and your business. No? Okay, well, I'm gonna ask Jaminia. Jaminia, are you okay with sharing with us, telling us a little bit about yourself and your business? You're muted. There you go.
Hi, everybody, I'm Jaminia. I guess you could say I'm like the jack of all trades. I've started multiple little small businesses out of my home. I've been doing taxes for 7 years. I just got involved in digital marketing, but I found a love for making t-shirts. So I'm trying to start that too. But I need to guess. I guess I'm joining this class to basically get a focus.
Very good. Thank you so much. Thanks everyone who shared. And as I said, please continue to share about yourself and your business in the chat. And I'm going to turn it back over to Adam.
Yeah, thank you, Dion. And thank you everybody for sharing. That shows that we have a lot of passion in this room and a lot of people who are looking to solve problems, both in the market and within our community and on just a broader scale. So with that, we'll get into the next slide here, which let's talk about. We're going to get into the education portion here. We're going to talk about, you know, what is the role of a business? And the role of a business is to solve a problem. Everybody gets into business because they either see a problem that needs to be solved or they have a solution and they're looking for a problem to solve it with. So, of course, with COVID-19 and the pandemic and everything that brings with it, there are new problems that exist in the market. There are new pains that have been created, new gaps that are existing, and even a need for new businesses that provide a level of enjoyment and pleasure and hit on those pleasure points. So just with business in general, there are gaps. So I'm going to share a little bit about my story. And I've run a few different startups. And the one that I ran right before I came to Buffalo was a laundry service where it was a pickup drop-off laundry service. We'd go to your house or to your place of business and pick up your laundry and then go and, wash, fold, wash, dry, and fold, and then return it to you. And what we saw in the market was a gap where, and actually I was in my apartment one night and it was a Sunday night and I thought, oh my gosh, I don't want to have to wear that pair of slacks tomorrow. They're a little snug. Maybe they're a little short at the ankles, you know, the cuffs a little short. I thought, man, I should have done laundry this weekend. I just didn't have time. I wish I could pay somebody to come pick my laundry up and take it. And that didn't exist where I was. So I saw that gap in the market and there was a major pain point there for me. I was like, I don't have time to do laundry on the weekends. I was traveling a lot for work. And so a couple of buddies and I started a business and we called it No Hamper. And we stopped to fill that gap. And so the problem we were solving was that there was nobody to provide that service yet. So we stepped in and decided to provide that service. And so as we go into the next slide, if you guys want to tell us in the chat box, what problem are you solving? What pain are you fixing? What pleasure are you bringing to people? What joy are you bringing to people? You think about places like, arcades and sporting events and salons and spas and any place where you go to kind of maybe relax or get enjoyment or, you know, a movie theater, even any type of entertainment, you know, it's not a problem, but it's a gap in the market that exists. People need to be entertained and they need to feel joy and businesses can bring that through different product and service offerings. So go ahead and tell us what you do. And so we've got people who fix grammar and spelling, and people who provide lawn care services. This is great. A lot of great feedback there. So with those problems, you have to create a solution. The business is the solution provider. And you as the entrepreneur or the small business owner are the person who is creating that service, creating that product, and then making sure that it gets into the hands of the proper people who are experiencing that pain. So you're filling that gap. You're easing that pain. And you're providing joy. I think one way I heard it was that you're bringing harmony to the market. You're bringing some sense of kind of balance and so that there isn't this shouting for, hey, we need this right now. We need this right now. And with No Hamper, at that time, I went into my office and my office had, it was interesting. I was one of four guys in that office and there were 32 or 33 women, most of them between the ages like 25 to 44. And a lot of them were single moms or moms who were working one or two or three jobs. And I went to them and I kind of pitched them the idea. I said, hey, you know, you guys all have kids. Here's the business idea I have. This is the solution I want to provide. What do you think of it? And they actually, you know, going directly to my market, they were able to help me kind of craft that solution. And, you know, they were able to tell me, hey, this is what works for me. This is what doesn't, you know, I don't want to have to bring my laundry to work. So please don't ask me to come pick, you know, please don't ask me to bring it to work. But if you pick it up at my house at like 6 o'clock, that'd be great because I can get home, put the laundry in the basket and then put it on the front steps or have it right by the door for when you come and pick it up. So we were able to build that solution with the input of the customer. And I think a lot of times, and you've seen businesses fail because of that. People who think that they're going to bring this product to the market, but they're not listening to the customers who they're trying to sell to. And, you know, just like Anthony has talked about, you know, you are the salesperson for your business, especially when you're the owner and you're in the startup phases, you're the salesperson. So if you don't know how to sell your product or you're not listening to what your customers are saying when they're telling you your solution is not fixing this, there's a higher chance of failure. But what you can do is listen to them and ask them, how can we be better? How can we better find this? How can we better solve this problem? And that's how you build a great solution.
Yeah, Adam, I think you hit that on the nail. I was going to chime in, but I think you spoke to that directly. Again, a lot of people like to build their business based on their preference. The market is going to tell you what products that they want and how they want it. So it's very, very crucial that you start listening. And you can start that from today. Just like in his statement, he went directly to who he thought was his customers and he asked for their feedback because that's how you're going to build it. So I really like that example. That was really good.
Thank you. Yeah, that's, you know, I'm actually, full disclosure, I'm in the middle of starting up a new company right now and it's for, it's basically an online like blog and podcast site for guys who just want to relax. And it's geared toward, you know, more towards guys who are in my age range, you know, mid to late 20s. I'll be turning 30 next month, but I'm not ready for that. So I'm still in my late 20s. I think I'll probably say I'm going to be in my late 20s. So I'm like 33 or 34. That's my goal here. But yeah, so I'm building that. And what I'm doing is I'm calling a lot of my buddies and a lot of my network who maybe fall into that bracket. I'm like, hey, what do you guys want to read? What do you want to hear about? What do you want to listen to? And, you know, I've been kind of surprised by their feedback. And it's, you know, they want to know, hey, what can I, you know, what should I binge on Netflix? And hey, you know, one thing that we've talked a lot about is, you know, mental health and things like that. So where I thought this was going to be, you know, a totally different site, you know, more towards, you know, kind of motorheads and sports and things like that. It's become more of a place where guys can feel safe to talk about, you know, mental health and struggles in their relationships and things like that. So now I'm creating the solution that the market wants. And I'm actually having more fun doing that than I was trying to kind of force feed the solution I thought I wanted to provide. So, but as we talk about solutions, we have to figure out if we are creating a product or a service, which is what this next slide is going to look at here. So as you provide a solution, you're creating either a product or a service. And you can think of it in this way. Products are something that we as customers use. So products are something that customers buy and they themselves use those. So you think about, and most of them are tangible. So it's, you know, think about food. So things like popcorn, sodas, burgers, it's, you know, the iPhone, and then your hair care products. Those are the things you take with you and you use, and you're in charge of how much you're going to use and how you're going to use them. Services, on the other hand, are rendered by the business. The business is in control of how things are being done. They are doing things for you that you can't or won't do for yourself. You're paying somebody else you're farming it out so that somebody else can provide a service to you. This is things like your insurance salesperson, your insurance claims adjuster, your accountant, your tax prep person, your attorney. A lot of us right now, especially in the startup phase, are working with those kind of people. You're making sure you have the right business insurance. You're making sure that your books are done right. You're making sure that you're set up legally. And you know, you have your LLC or your DBA or your S corp, whatever that is. Those are things that we don't have the expertise in. And so it makes more sense for us to go to somebody who does have that, and they provide the service of being an expert in that field, or provide the service of doing those things for us. This also goes, you know, home cleaning. I was sitting here last night and I was like, man, I wish I could have a person come in and clean my little tiny apartment, because I just don't like it. So it's people who, you know, services can be done by people who are experts, and maybe they have to have a certain type of license for it to provide that service. Or maybe it's something that you don't want to do, or you don't have the time to do. Much like with No Hamper, we were providing a service of doing laundry, because we knew that there were people who didn't like to do laundry or didn't have time to do laundry. There are people who don't have, you know, laundry equipment in their apartment or in their home or their townhouse. So it'd be great if they could farm that out to somebody like No Hamper. And so that was a service we were providing. You know, also things like hairstylists. Again, we go back to entertainment and having that pleasure and that joy in your life. And everybody likes to get a good haircut. I was telling the crew before we got started here, the reason you're not seeing my face is because I haven't had a haircut since March 6th. I don't remember my parents' anniversary date, but I remember the last time I had a haircut, and that was March 6th. It's a very important day to me. But because of the pandemic, I've not been able to get in there and get a haircut. And we'll talk more about that in just a minute, and I will continue to whine about my hair being too long. But we're going to put up another poll real quick. And that poll is going to ask you if you're providing a product or a service. And that poll is going to pop up on your screen here real quick. I want you guys to tell me, do you think you're providing a product, or do you think you're providing a service? And again, feel free to give us more information about your business in the chat. But if you can put up, you know, if you can answer the question in the poll, that'll help us understand who we're talking to. And, you know, there are those who, if we think about hair salons and spas, you know, they provide kind of both. There's the services they render. There's the massages and the haircuts and, you know, the face masks and all that they render those services. You don't take those home. You take a haircut home, you take your hair home, but you're not the one, you don't have to buy the scissors and do all that. You don't have a hair care kit, but you can buy, you know, shampoos and conditioners and toners and, you know, serums and eye creams and all that from those places. So those are products that they're selling. So some places have both. I think there's probably it looks like a lot of people are doing service businesses or both, which is interesting. That's great. Looks like 49% of our respondents are, so about half are doing service-based businesses. That's awesome. I think there's an argument to be made that we have, you know, like a restaurant provides both. They're providing you the product, they're providing you food, but they're preparing it for you, they're bringing it to you. All you have to do is kind of sit there and do you guys remember restaurants? Do you remember going in and sitting at restaurants? That I remember that used to happen back it feels like decades ago, but yeah, so that's you know, restaurants are kind of both. Barb, yes. Yeah, Barb, people went inside to eat at one point. Yeah. So yeah, let's move on to the next slide, and we'll take a look at, as we sell our product or service to really fill that, to provide a solution to those problems. The number one question we get, or the number one question we have to answer, and this is Anthony's phrase, is how do you get to your cash? And that's really the crux of, that's what a business model is. It tells you, how are you going to get to your cash? And so the dictionary definition is, you know, a design for the successful operation of a business, identifying revenue sources, customer base, products, and details of financing. Very boring, very academic, I like Anthony's explanation better of how do you get to your cash? And Anthony, if you want to, if this is a slide you want to kind of jump in on here and talk about how to get to your cash, I think it's a great place for everybody to kind of understand, you know, how, what are the ways I can get to my cash? You know, how will, you have to understand how your business will operate, who your customer is, how you'll reach your customer, and then how you're going to charge them, how you're going to get money from them. But Anthony, if you want to jump in.
Yeah, that is exactly how you, I phrased it. One of the things that we do very well is we look at the end goal, right? The end goal is I'm in business, I'm doing this for what, right? It's to get to a transaction between a person who needs your service or product, and then they actually get that service and pay you in a currency of agreements. Now, you're not gonna take a lamb or a goat because we don't do that anymore. So it's basically just looking at how do we actually get to the cash? How does our business function? A lot of people say, well, I have this new idea and people are going to want it. So when you start to design something that people have no idea about it, like an Apple product, right? Nobody had that idea. It takes a longer learning curve. So that's more education. But like some of your businesses, when you're trying to sell chess boards or you're trying to give an academic of teaching strategy through chess, or you're trying to sell people on hair design, that is what they need. That's how your business model functions. So when you do start to put your business plan together, your whole business plan is designed and telling an investor or yourself, how do I actually get to that transaction and how does that customer feel at the end of it? And that's truly how you start to look at and start to formulate these activities and make it relevant to what you're doing. Because like you said, that definition is so boring and it's so like high detail, but the real point is how do I make somebody really feel great about their hair? And how do they want it? And I'm doing it based on their needs instead of mine. So that's definitely an important part to implementing your business.
Yeah, and you know, with the business model, we have to, you know, you always want to keep in mind, you know, how are the competitors doing it? And how is, you know, what's the best way for me to get to that cash? And what is the best way for me to market? Your business has to have self-awareness, and it has to know where its place is in the market at every phase in its life, which really is a nice segue into the next slide, and the next topic where we talk about feasibility. And we ask some basic questions of, you know, does my solution solve the problem? And does this ease the pain within the market? Does it fill the gap? Does it bring that joy we're trying to bring? And then also, can my business exist in this market, the market that I'm trying to fit into? I mean, there's, you know, I'm from a really small town in Indiana of about 2,000 people. And this question of, can my business exist in this market? Is there space for it? This is the question that ultimately changed the trajectory of No Hamper. And to get to a point where we were profitable, we knew that our population size had to be more than, you know, the closest city to us, the closest town to us with more than 2,000 people was, you know, 30,000, and there was another one with 50,000. But within that, there's not a whole lot of money. I mean, you think with our price points being between $12 and $15 per, you know, regular size basket of laundry, there's not a lot of folks who are willing to pay that $12 to $15 to get a load of laundry done, or maybe even two loads of laundry done. You know, it's a lot cheaper to go down to the laundromat themselves and take a Saturday and do it for a few dollars each. And because of that, we had to realize that we were not in a market that our business could succeed. And had we been in a larger city, had we been closer to Indianapolis, had we been, you know, close, or, you know, even in a city like Buffalo or like Rochester with a little more population, there's a chance that we could have been more successful. But because we asked ourselves that question of, can my business exist in this market? Is there space for it? we knew that we couldn't survive. And we ran all these numbers. We're like, you know, unless we uproot our lives and move, you know, 60 miles towards, you know, central, you know, into Indianapolis, we're not going to be able to do this. So, and one tool that we used to get to that point was the SWOT analysis. And the SWOT analysis, hey, is, it's an acronym. Yeah. Yeah.
Before you go into that, I think you hit on a key part. A lot of people, when you say a product and service, that's good, but you got to dive a little deeper into it. You got to start looking, are you a needs business versus a want business? If you're a needs business, then you're going to continue to see a cash flow. That's money coming into your business because people need it. But if you are a want business, you really have to look at your market, because that one business needs to understand, like, hey, does this person who I'm targeting have disposable income, or are they buying stuff check to check? Are they, or what are they doing? How frequent, how often? So when you look at this feasibility study, it is super important to look exactly what your business is a need versus a want, and then who actually can buy this if it's a want business? Who needs to buy it? So I think that's really a good part to look at, especially when you start to determine like who your customer is and then go into your SWOT analysis. So yeah, that was definitely a good point to bring up.
No, that's a great, and I'm going to piggyback on that. And, you know, I'll give you a really good story here with No Hamper. When it's kind of in the last days of No Hamper, we were trying to make this decision on if we wanted to keep it alive. And I had gone into my 9-to-5 and I was talking to the women there, and they were asking me, they're like, hey, when are you going to start this business? When are you going to get it to a point where we can use it? And I said, well, you know, for us to get our operations to a point where we could drop our price enough, we would have to hit some crazy critical mass. And to do that, we would have to move closer to Indianapolis, which means we would not be able to service you guys. So what originally started out as this service that we wanted to provide to, you know, a lot of single moms and kind of working professionals who may be younger and early in their careers and don't have a ton of disposable income. And what started out as that, we realized we just couldn't make it work financially. So the solution that we were providing didn't really fix the problem we saw. Now, we've seen this solution work in other places, but it solves a little different problem. It's more of a convenience issue. And there are places like in Houston, Texas, where this idea works. And it's for people who have a crazy amount of disposable income and they can pay $15 to $20 to get their laundry done, you know, $15 per load, you know, per, you know, one basket to get their laundry done. And that's just not feasible. I don't think I would pay, you know, $15 or $20 to get my laundry done. I do pay to get it done now, but I have to take it in. I have to drop it off myself and pick it up myself. And I pay, you know, for, you know, two or three loads of laundry, I end up paying, you know, $20 or $25, which is, you know, half or a third of the price of what I would have to, you know, what No Hamper was going to charge. So it's, making sure that your solution matches up with the market you're trying to serve. And if it doesn't, you know, either re-engineering the product or service or serving a different market. And you have to really think about that. But the SWOT analysis, again, is it's an acronym, and it means you're going to examine the strengths and weaknesses of your business, which are internal things. Those are things about the business itself. What are my strengths? What are my weaknesses? And then you're also going to examine your opportunities, the opportunities that exist to your business within the market. You know, where are these, you know, what do you see as a new space you can fill, or a new demographic you can reach, or a new product you can offer? And then the threats. What are the external threats? Who are your competitors? What disasters are currently going on? Is there a pandemic? Are you in an area like the Outer Banks in North Carolina, where there's a lot of hurricanes? Are you in, you know, on the coast of Florida where there's hurricanes? Are you in Buffalo where there's an abnormal amount of snow every year? You know, what are those external threats, both physical and also just market-based threats that exist here? And so I want to kind of get into some examples of those. And the first one is Nike. And So let's talk about the strengths of Nike. So we're going to go through this one. We're going to go through another example, and then I'm going to bring everybody in and kind of ask you guys to talk about your own businesses and what strengths and weaknesses and opportunities and threats exist within your own businesses. So some strengths of Nike are the product quality, the name recognition, and that they're linked with star athletes. They have great people who, they have these huge names that they have sponsorship deals with, and that reaches people, and people want to dress like LeBron and, Michael Jordan and those guys and Derek Jeter and anybody who wears that Nike brand. And actually, I was telling Anthony before we got on today that my hair's so long. I bought a hairband for myself from Nike, like an athletic headband. So, and I was like, and I knew I needed one, and I just went to Amazon and typed in Nike headband. I didn't type in, generic headband. I wanted a Nike one because I know it's a quality product, and I like having the swoosh on my forehead. Right now, I'm drinking from a Nike water bottle, and I'm wearing Nike tennis shoes. So, some of the weaknesses within Nike, though, are it has a crazy dependency on the U.S. Market, athletic apparel market. And so if somebody else comes in and takes that, Nike's going to struggle. Or if the United States has an economic downturn like it's going through right now, Nike's sales fell 38% last quarter because of the pandemic. And then, things like labor rights and worker conditions overseas where they have these factories and people are not working in the greatest conditions. Those are weaknesses that Nike has. And they've acknowledged that. Some opportunities that exist for Nike are, developing markets like India, China, and Brazil. And, as well as, some innovative products they can put out, different types of athletic wear and different types of athletic accessories. And I know like my water bottle, I upgraded to a different water bottle, which is really minor, but I don't have to flip up anything or screw anything on. I just kind of squeeze the bottle and get water. But then some threats that exist to Nike right now. COVID-19 is threatening its retail sales. Adidas and Under Armour and Lululemon and all these competitive athletic brands are coming out. And, maybe there's somebody on this call today who has a clothing brand or an athletic apparel brand who's going to come out and compete with Nike. So we'll go through McDonald's here kind of quick, just kind of going through that again. McDonald's, their strengths. Why do people buy from them? What are their selling points? What sets them apart? They have a great price. McDonald's food is cheap. Everybody knows McDonald's, great name recognition, and they're quick and easy for the most part. They're really, really convenient. I know that there have been times during the pandemic where I have not wanted to go out and get food, so I've ordered McDonald's and had it here just as quickly as if I would have gone out and gotten it myself. Some of their weaknesses, poor food quality and nutritional value, and just personal, why is an ice cream machine always broken? Sometimes a guy just wants some ice cream. And so I put that as one of their weaknesses. Their opportunities, they have the opportunity to deliver now. McDonald's delivers, which I said 10 years ago, if McDonald's delivered, I'd be 800 pounds. So I'm glad they didn't do it till recently. They also have an opportunity to expand their menu, and they're adding more salads and wraps and things like that. Some threats externally, there's Grubhub and DoorDash and Postmates and Uber Eats. And then their competition just in food is Burger King and Wendy's and Checkers. And I'm sure that we have some people on the call today who are starting restaurants or starting some sweet treat shops. And, you guys are threats to McDonald's. So continue to compete with them. And maybe one day you'll bring down the machine. So one thing that we don't have a ton of time for, but one thing I want you guys to put in the chat is, we're going to send out a worksheet on this between now and the next workshop, is I want you guys to think about your own strengths and weaknesses and opportunities and threats that exist in your business. What do you do really well? How do you compete with your competitors? Why do people buy from you? That's what your strengths are. Answering those questions gives you your strengths. Let me think about what our weaknesses are. Where are we most vulnerable? What do our customers want that we can't provide, or that we are unwilling to provide, or we can't provide well? What are the opportunities that exist in the market? What gaps exist that we can fill? Who is sleeping so that we can leapfrog them? Who is not paying attention that we can jump over? The thing about there's this blue ocean strategy, and I'll make it really simple. It's what's brand new? What has nobody ever done before? And how can we go out and do that? How can we be the first person out there? And then threats. You think about threats to the business that exist in the market. Things like who your competition is. Why are they beating you? Where are they beating you? What are regulations? What are laws that threaten to restrict your ability to provide your product or service to your customers? And then what vulnerabilities to disasters, damage, and downturns do you have? You think about disasters like COVID-19. You think about blizzards, hurricanes, tornadoes, and then you think about damage and the damage that comes from natural disasters or man-made disasters. And then you think about downturns, economic downturns, and, you know, maybe issues that exist within the market. Hey, we don't, you know, you think in the last 10 years, there's been a different view of fast food, or maybe the last 20 years, there's maybe more emphasis on health. And how's that impacting fast food? And then also, how's that impacting Nike? Where McDonald's loses, maybe Nike gets to pick up because people are spending less money on junk food, and they're going to go to Nike and buy more headbands and tennis shoes and dry fit wear.
Hey, Adam.
Yeah.
I just want to chime in on, so a SWOT analysis is very good for you to just pick apart your business. But one of the things as an investor that we look at is that opportunity part. And I just want to dive a little deeper into that blue ocean. I recently saw a workshop that talked about innovation versus improvement. Now, a lot of people think they're being innovative when they create something new, but sometimes it's actually just improving. The scenario that he gave was, and everybody can do this, think about a desk, right? In your head, start thinking about if you were going to build a desk company, right? You were going to put the best desk on the market. What comes to mind, right? And you can start putting that in the chat. What comes to mind when I say build the best desk? What would you put on that desk? And you can start throwing that in the chat. Well, a lot of people started to write, they would put features on a desk. It still would be a rectangle, still would be a square. But he looked at it and said, those things aren't innovative, they're just improvement. And he said the innovative part was when people look at a desk from a whole new perspective. And one of the people came up with a circular object that was submerged in the bottom of a pool, and it had all these tech features where you would push and you would sit at this stool and in the middle and just push, and then that would be your computer. If you look at that, that is innovation, right? Versus improvement. So when you're thinking about what you're doing in this business, that opportunity is key. What are you doing that's innovative versus just an improvement? And we've seen that work a lot in this market. We could talk about Apple if we needed to look at a big company, how they brought out the iPod, the iPhone. They took something and they redesigned it to make it fit into what they thought would be more convenient for their consumer. So think about that as you're designing your business. Are you doing something that's an improvement to what already exists? Or are you actually doing something that is innovative, that's thinking beyond the box? That's all.
That's a great point, Anthony. And I think, you know, as Anthony has shown here, as you start thinking about your business and thinking through these questions and these problems, it is invaluable to have a mentor in place to help you, to help guide you through that thought process. And that's one thing that Pathstone provides, is mentorship, both within the staff. And then we also have great partners within the community, like Duncan and like Anthony. And we provide this mentorship. Myself, I have mentors that I lean on, and I've gotten to a point, and I am I'm humbled by this, that business owners have come to me and asked me to be their mentor as they go through their process of starting and running a business. And, you know, they can really help you do these objective analysis. They are an objective outsider who can look at the business through a more critical lens and tell us, you know, where we may be missing things. And at Pathstone, we serve as mentors to business owners and entrepreneurs. And we even help write business plans for folks, and which is what we'll be doing in this workshop. So in terms of business plans, we're going to put up one more poll here and ask you where you are in your business plan process. We're going to put that up. Have you written one yet? Is it complete? Are you in the process of writing one, or do you just not have one yet? And there's no right answer. The right answer is the truth answer, because that lets us know the truthful answer. That lets us know where we are and how we can best help. And then we're also going to put up a poll right after this asking, you know, who has a business mentor? But it looks like, so it's kind of 50-50, about half have a business plan and half don't. So that's a pretty good spread there. I like that. That's good to know. And there's some overachievers here who have completed their business plan. So good for you guys. We'll be getting into that more as we go through the series. But I think we have one more poll here as well, where we ask, do you have a business mentor? And that can be somebody you lean on to say, hey, help me write my business plan, or does this sound like a good idea? Somebody who's kind of that consultant or that other brain in the room who can help you think critically and think through the challenges you may face as a business owner and as you start this business ownership and business startup process. And if you want to, as you answer this question, you can put in the chat if you would like to be contacted about business mentorship, and we can contact you and have those conversations and make sure we get you with the right fit within our program. Because sometimes it's as easy as, you know, hey, I just need to run this idea by somebody and see if it's crazy. Or, you know, hey, I've got this idea. I've got it all thought out. Can you help me get to launch? Or can you help me get to the point where I'm, where I'm profitable? And there are definitely points within the business life cycle where it's, hey, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to exit. I either want to sell or shut down or step away from daily operations. I need somebody to walk me through that. And we can provide help and assistance in all of that. So we'll do a real quick recap here on this next slide. It's, remember, businesses are problem solvers. You're providing a solution to a problem. So you need to first know the problem and then know how you are solving the problem. And you have to know where you fit in the market. Remember, like we talked with No Hamper, we didn't fit in the market we were trying to serve. We had to move to better serve a market, to make our business feasible. Otherwise, we would have been able to serve the market we wanted to for about 25 minutes, and then we would have gone bankrupt. So if the question is, where do you fit in the market? And then the all-important question, the reason most of us are here today, know how to get to your cash. What is that business model? How am I serving my customer? How are they paying me? How am I getting to them? How am I going to grow my business with that money? How do you get to your cash? And then, of course, the SWOT analysis, understanding the feasibility, understanding those strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats that exist internally and within the market so that you can be the best business you can be and be proactive in marketing and protecting your business. And remember, guys, you're here because you have a dream. You have a goal. You want a life for yourself that nobody else can provide for you. No one will live your dream for you. And because of that, nobody else can stop you from living your dream. Don't let them. Make the life you desire. And this is going to sound really corny, and it's something that my dad has said for my entire life. Don't be afraid to be great. There's a lot of work involved in this, but you guys can do it. You're here. This is an incredible step to take. So I think we've touched on this. You guys know that we usually these workshops are in person. And we usually provide you guys with lunch or dinner on us. And since we can't be in person, we do want to send you a meal voucher to one of the four places listed here on the screen. There's Manna and Taste of Siam in Buffalo. And then there's Damn Good Chicken and Peppa Pot in Rochester. If you guys will put in the chat, you have to put it in the chat so we make sure we get it to you. Put in the chat where you want to go for lunch, and we will make sure we get that voucher to you in the next couple of days. And lunch is on us. And this is Anthony.
Sorry about that. Really quickly, I saw the chat in there. A question. I don't know if somebody got to answer this, but it says by Mike B. The funding that was mentioned, is it a grant or a loan only? Sorry if I missed that. So after you talk about the food, if you can just go back and talk about if y'all provide grants or loans only.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I was getting ready to open up for questions, so thanks for prompting that. Real quick, just make sure, it looks like everybody's putting their food choice down there. So for Pathstone, we do primarily business financing through lending. We do a lot of small business loans. We go from, $5,000 up to $250,000. Startups, we stay on the low end. And if you're an established business, we can go up a little higher. And that's, again, that's all based on, credit worthiness and also the strength of the business and the business idea. So with that, we're coming to the end here. I want to be respectful of everybody's time, but what questions do you guys have? How can we, and feel free to type it in the chat or speak up, and Anthony and I can answer your questions as best we can.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm not sure.
Hi.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay, so yeah. Hi, Anthony. I would like to know that when we are making a marketplace, how can we? What are the things that we should see that a marketplace is needed for that kind of service?
So when you make a mock of the actual, workshop frame, is that what you're saying?
No, a marketplace.
Oh, marketplace. Yeah. Okay. So you're trying to make a marketplace?
Yeah.
And what are you, is it a B2B or B2C?
It's a B2B, B2C, okay. Sorry, B2B.
So you're gonna create a marketing plan, a marketplace for people to buy on your platform, like a Etsy, eBay, something like that?
It's a service marketplace for consultants.
Oh, so like Fiverr. Okay, yeah, let's talk offline. I got your information. Unless other people are specific in that, I think that's more of a your question. So I will reach out to you directly to answer that question for you.
Yeah, sure. I sent you a connect on LinkedIn also. We can talk there.
Okay, yeah, definitely. Thank you. I want to be respectful of people's time, and that's more specifically to your industry. So I'll definitely answer that one back. But any other questions?
This is Anthony talking or Adam? Sorry, I didn't get.
It's Anthony talking.
Okay, sorry. Anthony, I couldn't get you on LinkedIn. I got Adam, but I couldn't see you on LinkedIn.
Adam, someone had a question about how to take their dormant LLC and convert it to a 501c3.
Oh, man, that is a great question. I actually wrote it down. I will get their name and then... That is a question that I am not educated enough to answer right here on the spot, but we can definitely get you an answer. It may be as simple as just filling out a few pieces of paper. I know that 501c3s take an incredible amount of paperwork, but I don't know what the process is or if there is one for transferring or going from a for-profit into a nonprofit, or if you just have to create a brand new standalone entity with complete separation. But I can, I'll get the information there so I can answer that question better. So I know there's a lot of 501c3 questions here. We can send out information on 501c3 stuff when we send out these slides and all the information on the slides. Because I know there's a lot of questions on that.
I just have a quick question.
As a question, if I don't have a business plan, when is the deadline for one during stages of my development for future projects?
Yeah, great question. So what we're going to be doing is in week week seven, we're going to take all the previous six classes, including this one, and put them into the business plan. And I have a template set up. There's, it's really a bunch of worksheets that we'll fill out together. And then you'll be able to bring that to graduation in week eight. So there's the deadline is something that I'm managing, and I am, what I would do is just, you know, if you can keep notes, have a notebook for this class, for this workshop, and, you know, kind of follow along. And the business plan is going to focus on the problem, the solution, and how you're making it sustainable. And there's going to be questions in there like, who's your market? Who are you selling to? What are you selling them? How are you getting it to them? So be thinking about those questions, and we will make sure you are, everybody's ready for the business plan once we get to that week. There's a question here. Is there any focus on bookkeeping? Yes. So we do have a week that is devoted entirely for an hour and a half to financial statements and things like that. And we can also in that week talk about bookkeeping for a few minutes, but we can also go ahead and anybody who's interested in bookkeeping, I will get your name in the chat I saw there, and we can make sure we get you set up with the proper resources to learn how to bookkeep and to do that in a way that's not incredibly time consuming, but also beneficial to the business.
Adam, Kiana had a question about the maximum credit, personal credit score one would need to be able to qualify for a business loan. I'm not sure if she's asking about a business loan with Pathstone or with a traditional bank.
Yeah, so traditional banks typically want you to be no lower than like 650 or 635, right in there. That's kind of their lowest. With Pathstone, we look at more than just the credit score. We look at the credit score and the credit report to see the story of the credit history. But we also look at, you know, what's going on right now. What's the business doing? What's the business plan? What are your personal, what's your personal financial situation? And, you know, what is the business projected to do? How far along are you in your business process? And, you know, we don't have check boxes. We don't have, you know, some algorithm that tells us, okay, or, you know, some formula that says you have to have a 650 credit score and you have to make, you know, $200,000 a year. And you have, no, it's not like that. Because we are community-based and nonprofit, we can make decisions based on our mission rather than just dollars and cents.
Before everybody leaves, I just want to, Adam, if you could go through the next slide, because I think people are starting to jump off. I do want to encourage you all to return for part two of this series, and Adam can talk to that. People are asking about financial management and credit. We are halfway through our Money Talk series that is specifically designed to address those questions and to help people repair and improve their credit scores. And then this Friday and every other Friday, we have a small business forum. And we are inviting you to our small business forum. This Friday, we have four guests who will be on the call. These are all people who have managed to either start or grow their business during the coronavirus pandemic. It'll be a very insightful call. And the forum is for you to, it's part of your development and training. So take the opportunity to register and attend the forum this Friday. It's at 11. We will be meeting on Zoom as we do all of our programs. Adam, do you want to talk about Bootcamp Part 2?
Sure. So we have, next week we'll be talking about the market and your sales plan. And so we'll be talking about who you're trying to reach and then how to reach them, who your customer is and how to sell to them. And Sandra Courtney will be our presenter on that next week. And She does a fantastic job. I'm excited to watch her do this. So guys, make sure you're on the lookout for your meal voucher. That'll be coming to your email. And remember that you need 4 out of the 7 sessions. So 4 out of the 7 Mondays that we have these, you need to be present in so that we can invite you to graduation. We would love to have everybody graduate from this. You'll get a certificate. And then we invite you to the next series, which is kind of that next level. And remember, we have prizes for those who attend the most sessions. So come and earn your prizes. I want to say thank you to everybody who helped make today possible with this next slide. And so thank you to first to Duncan for getting us started and getting everybody energized and engaged and staying focused. I know he energized me. So thank you, Duncan, for doing that. And thank you, Anthony and Spa Capital Management for partnering with us today and helping us create this series and being an incredible expert in the room and co-creator of this program. And I want to thank Dion and Jahida for helping me navigate this and running the chat and running the polls and to Jahida for just designing a presentation that people want to look at instead of mine that was like beige background with black text. So thank you for that. And if there's nothing else, we will see you guys next week. If you have any questions for us, please leave them in the chat here as we close out, or feel free to reach out to us through our social media on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And we will see you guys next week. Same bat time, same bat channel.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great week.